hydroxychloroquine. Try it.
I trust vaccines. I trust scientists. But I don't trust Donald Trump.
This is the most deceptive, vicious world, full of lies and deceit.
What in the world is happening on Wall Street?
Many investors assume these securities were trustworthy.
The UK voted to leave the European Union.
We fought against big politics. We fought against lies, corruption, and deceit. Honesty wins.
Are we at a moment of crisis of democracy and trust in politics? Yes, we are. Although it's getting harder and harder to talk about a crisis because a crisis is supposed to be an acute moment. The crisis moments are becoming more frequent.
I don't trust politicians. Whatever they say they're going to do never happens.
Deceiver, a liar, fake. People look out for themselves only, you know, not caring about the real people.
Dirty tactics and nastiness. Why would you want to get involved in that?
What happened to the integrity? What happened to the fact check? What happened to a point where this stuff wasn't even aired?
Trust goes to the center of all politics. Declines in trust get to the heart of the question of whether democratic politics is sustainable. About why different countries have different sorts of regime. Is the sort of liberal democracy that we have in the United Kingdom sustainable? Where might the challenges come from? And so trust for me gives us many of the answers, or at least many of the warning signs about how politics might change and might be changing.
When it comes to the trust in politicians, I would say it's at an all-time low. And in fact, we've been in this slow decay, punctuated by moments of crisis since at least the late 1980s, I would say. The problem is that the frustration and the anger are so profound that they might actually get rid of democracies. In some countries, it's already happening. You take Brazil, you take Hungary. The US, which for a long time claimed to be an exception, but now January 6th has proven that here too, democracy can backslide and disappear.
It is a crisis when many big, important countries are experiencing a crisis of trust, especially the United States and the United Kingdom. France and Spain, Italy, Brazil and Australia. These countries dominate our media system, our culture, our geopolitics. So even if it's not universal, that is a clear problem for the world as a whole. Curiously, we tend to see often the highest levels of reported trust in kind of the most authoritarian countries in the world. The highest levels of trust reported in surveys are in China. Russia as well, it's interesting that there are fairly high levels of trust there. And it looks like trust has been going up as it becomes more authoritarian, which is worrying.
In China, the sustained high levels of economic growth are associated with improvements in the quality of life for citizens, also with national pride. It suggests that actually citizens can place trust in governments who are delivering them benefits but aren't necessarily delivering them rights. And so it points to an issue that perhaps a high level of trust might be good in particular contexts, but it's not necessarily a bad thing for citizens to be distrusting or mistrustful of governments that don't necessarily protect their interests. Trust, we understand, as a belief that someone will act in our interest, that I trust you to do something for me. Distrust, I'm suspicious of you, I'm cynical about your behaviors, your actions. Mistrust is quite different from the others. It's the idea that we might just be skeptical about how someone might behave, that we might believe a government might not act in our interest and we should monitor them carefully.
I think almost everyone that's done comparative analysis would say that there are some countries that have had sustained trust. Denmark and other Scandinavian countries. Other countries like the United States, where there clearly seems to be a significant decline of trust, and countries like Britain, where things are more in the middle.
When we have very low levels of trust, we also tend to have polarization in society. Big groups of people who don't trust the government and other groups who might trust it, depending on who's in control and so forth. These tend to be cultural tensions that go beyond politics. You see that especially in the US. People start disliking each other personally, socially, not being around each other. We see rises of violence between these groups.
There's a question that we ask regularly. We've been doing this since 1958, and it asks people, do you trust the government in Washington to do what's right? Almost always, most of the time, or just some of the time? Back in 1964, over 70% of Americans said either just about always or most of the time. Now fewer than 20% of people say they trust the government in Washington to do what's right. Starting with the Bush presidency, during the Obama and Trump presidencies, there has been this incredible polarization of trust. North Carolina and Texas are very evenly divided between Republicans and Democrats. Both have a set of cities and universities, and those areas are Democratic blue. And then they also have very rural parts of the state. Religious orientation is much stronger, and those are Republican dark red. And so what we have are these islands, a 50-50 mix, but nobody on the right encounters anybody on the left because we all live in our little bubbles. And this is true of the United States in general.
You have to be very careful with who you tell that you're a Republican. And used to, you could sit around and you could talk about who you voted for. You voted for him, I voted for him, and that's fine. You could shake hands and have a dinner together. Now it's totally opposite. I watched the election results the entire night, and I watched exactly when the shift happened, just like a lot of people did. I do not trust the voting machines. Fraud calls that. I still believe that. Anytime a person on the right says fraud, we're viewed as conspiracy theorists. I still, to this day, do not understand how a current president who barely won his party's nomination, and that is the current administration. I wasn't born yesterday. Okay, let's just put it that way.
I know your pain. I know you're hurt. We had an election that was stolen from us. It was a landslide election, and everyone knows it, especially the other side. This was a fraudulent election.
American politicians have truly lost their integrity and the respect of our people in America. We live in an America where a former president is literally telling people, in the next few months, I'll be reinstated during a current president's term. We have a battle over facts and non-facts. In America right now, it is factual that African Americans are dying at a disproportionate rate in regards to law enforcement.
I want people to understand that the movement for change, it's much bigger here in Dallas.
We live in an America where an officer believes it's okay to put his knee on the neck of a man for 9 minutes and that body be lifeless. And yet at the end of the day, we're supposed to trust in the American policing system. people are tired of just words. The only way that trust is built with actions.
As a former police officer, I think that the Black Lives Movement has really hurt the country. Now, if you disagree with someone, and if it happened to be an African American, you're racist. It's really created a boiling pot in our society right now. I really lost trust back in the Obama-Biden years.
Low trust matters. Democracy was truly on the brink January 2021 with a president actively working to undermine the result of a free and fair election. Donald Trump is a perfect match for this particular time. How did a character like that get in office? Because most Americans don't trust the government in Washington to do what's right. And they go along with anything to stop the other side from being in charge. Yes.
Typically your friend group and the people you associate with all believe the same thing as you. So like in West Texas, you're gonna get pretty much only Republicans. But in the heart of Dallas, it's gonna be all Democrats. I used to be an anti-vaxxer. I was alone in West Texas and my husband was working all the time. I had a toddler, like this was the community I was looking for. It was as if every anti-vaxxer in America found each other all at once. So we were all friending each other up to the 5,000 friend limit mark. A lot of them believe that magnets will stick to the arm that was vaccinated. And a lot of them believe that nanoparticles were injected so that we could be tracked by Bill Gates. We were like, no way is a vaccine coming close to our child. I was so entrenched in the anti-vaccine cult. A majority of them believe in QAnon. They're into Pizzagate. They think the Clintons eat babies. I was kind of excommunicated from their community when I even toyed around with the idea of Western medicine. To think that I bought into it when my child was left vulnerable to diseases. I'm very lucky that she didn't catch anything dangerous. I do feel tricked.
The pandemic has meant a lot of people have been isolated. You can see how they seek solace in these groups. Online disinformation and conspiracies is not limited to the corners of the internet. It's not limited to social media, and it very much spills over into people's real lives. I've interviewed people who have lost loved ones because they thought that COVID wasn't real, that it was caused by 5G. They didn't follow health guidance, they didn't seek help. And it's really devastating when you interview people who have had someone die. There's this misconception that people who are susceptible to conspiracy theories are gullible. And I actually find it's the opposite. They often have become hyper-engaged and are people who have not benefited from the system. Either they've experienced racism or they haven't had much money or they've generally just had legitimate, quite bad times. They found themselves more likely to believe this stuff because why should they trust the people who have otherwise let them down? People are able to turn to Facebook groups or Telegram channels or other messaging apps to seek out other people who might be similarly distrustful. So it's a place where bad actors can deliberately exploit that distrust. We've seen a number of conspiracy influencers that have grown huge followings online, looking to increase their political influence or to make money or just to have a big online presence. And the people who are most likely to follow them or fall foul of those mysteries are people who are distrustful of politicians, of those in charge.
I think the reason that we've seen such explosion in conspiracy theories, it comes back to that question of the sense of powerlessness that many people feel. They look at what's going on up there in, you know, the state, in business, and they think that's very far away from me, I'm never going to be able to impact it. And they therefore assume that there is kind of, you know, a group of people that exists completely not subject to democratic accountability who are moving all of the pieces on the chessboard. A lot of the time that isn't that far away from the truth. You go into the supermarket and it looks like you're being met with all of these different brands, which are all of these different companies. But actually, if you look at the ownership of those brands, it's about four or five massive international corporations that own a huge proportion of everything we eat, everything we buy. We may feel like we live within a free market system, but actually the powerful at the very top of those corporations really get to shape who gets what. And suddenly the idea that we do actually live in a democracy starts to look much more suspect.
Two important signs of democracy are shared respect and a shared power.
We've always had a problem with trust in politics. The main characteristic of capitalism is that it generates expectations that it cannot fulfill. It is constantly injecting people's hearts and minds with hope, optimism, expectations, and then constantly violating them after a brief period of depression, doing it all over again.
We want democracy without capitalism. They want capitalism without democracy.
There is a touching belief that capitalism and democracy go hand in hand, that they are complementary. My view is exactly the opposite, that capitalism is inconsistent with democracy. We have two voting schemes. One is the market. The more pounds and dollars and euros you have, the more votes you cast. And occasionally, every 4 or 5 years, we have the illusion of one person, one vote.
This is election day.
To get a government in, which effectively is chosen between two parties representing in slightly different ways the interests of property owners, of shareholders. That's not democracy, and it was never meant to be a democracy.
For some people, it's completely rational not to trust, or even to have no interest, because politics has never benefited them. But then it's also completely rational for other people to have high levels of trust, or be really involved because politics can benefit them. So I don't think it's about people's political knowledge or about their education level. For some people, it's completely rational to think that politics is something that's alien to them and that will never benefit them. And that is something that we've got to change. And I think that the onus of that is on government or on institutions, that you need to show people that politics can benefit you. But you just need to get involved.
I don't trust politicians because they tell lies when it suits. They make you vote for them, they promise you the earth, and then when they get in, then they change the goalposts. Whoever's in power don't affect my life. They can't help me. They don't help me. I help myself. I believe they're turning people against each other, like Black Lives Matter and all these other things. Like, I worked with gang members, yeah, when I was a kid. I could go in any area in South London where I grew up, any area, and I'd be known and know people and have friends everywhere. Now you go to another post, they want to stab you. You know why the government are separating people, don't you? While we're all busy fighting each other, we're not going against them. Yeah, if we all stuck together and everybody was united together, yeah, we're strong.
The politicians don't realise how tough it is, I think, for young people growing up. I know, like, the gym here, they do a lot of work with kids that are troubled or, you know, need, like, to get them into better activities, get them off the streets. And there's not a lot of funding and things like that. It's quite sad, really, because I think there is a lack of representation for certain areas, definitely.
The first thing you'll see in the morning, the first thing you go on, for my age, is Instagram or Twitter, not the Daily Mail or the Times. So I do think, without realising, we let our peers and social media shape our opinions on matters. I probably am quite a fence-sitter, because I don't really like to get involved in political conversation. I normally vote for Conservative because my dad tells me to. But my sister in the same house is Labour, so.
over the last century or so. People are really tied to their party identity. They actually called themselves Labour Conservative. That's now the lowest it's ever been. Voters can't be taken for granted. Their political identities have changed, and they really will leave you in the blink of an eye if they think you're not representing their concerns. That seems to me to be the pivotal question about trust. The key thing that's changed in the UK now is that you do have a governing party that has won a bunch of seats in the North and the Midlands for the first time, very working class seats, and they now really know that they need to hold on to them. Now that means, whether for the right reasons or not, that those voters are being listened to a bit more by the Conservative Party, by the government. That's what explains the Conservative Party still winning elections 11 years on and winning the seat of Hartlepool. You get this in pretty much any part of the UK, even in Wales. Whether the Conservative Party would eventually let their voters down obviously does remain to be seen.
People are losing the link that they've had with their parents and their grandparents before them. You know, I would knock on doors 20 years ago where people would say, I've always been Labour because my dad was Labour, my mum was Labour, my grandparents were Labour. Now we're finding people more open to different offers. So the party that wins that support is the party that appeals to what their future offer is. And at the last election, Labour didn't do that. What's happened is there's been big structural changes in the economy and in the social fabric of the society in places like this. I think people feel abandoned by life generally because, you know, the steel industry, which employed 30,000 people just down the river here, now employs 1,000 people. The coal mine that employed 3,000 people 20 years ago now employs nobody. The new industries are different types of industries and people have not been prepared for that.
I voted for the Conservative candidate, so I'm a floating voter. We've got a government that's been thrown into a pandemic straight away. They've tried putting things in place for self-employed, for employed, and I look at that and I think, you know what? They've looked after us. I look at the new Labour leader, Keir Starmer. I trust them both, actually.
You show them a Conservative argument. They say, oh, OK, I'll probably vote Conservative based on that. Show them a Labour argument. They say, I'll probably vote Labour. There's a pendulum swinging, even in that focus group, about where they'd land. So their votes are very transactional, they're very fleeting, and they're very transient. And it really is much easier for either party to now grab them.
What we know is a lot of political trust is often driven by a lot of social trust, which is, do you trust your neighbours? Do you trust people that are around you? The Nordic countries have had the advantage of having relatively successful economies, fantastic welfare systems, and are relatively homogeneous societies. And I think they therefore have really quite high levels of social trust. And that social trust helps to feed into their sustained political trust.
In all Scandinavian countries, government takes care of the people. So this is why they trust him. So it's also based on this stronger welfare state, providing for the people, having like general health insurance and all the other welfare benefits.
My mom is quite sick. A lot of psychiatrist diagnosis. So she have had a lot of help from the healthcare system. And I know if it was in the USA, she would have been a lot worse. I would have had to work a full-time job just to take care of her. Instead, I have had the possibility to go to university. That helped me to grow up as a normal citizen, even though my parents wasn't as well off as many others. I definitely couldn't have been where I was today if it wasn't for the welfare state. You can say I'm more motivated to give something back to it now because I have benefited from it earlier in my life. It's quite easy to meet our politicians in our daily life.
Kritikken har altid været fra den borgerlige side, at man ikke ønsker at bruge.
The main objective for politicians is to make people believe that we can change things, that we can actually make decisions against whoever has a lot of power in society. If we don't do that, we'd have a lot of different groups feeling as victims of something else or someone else. I have a constituency of around 20,000 people as an MP in Denmark. In Britain, it's more like 100,000. So it does bring decisions closer to people.
Political trust, it goes up and down. There's a cyclical component in the sense that when the economy is doing badly, there's a tendency for voters to blame the government. On the other hand, if the economy is doing well, then trust can climb again. But it certainly is true that in Denmark, we have not seen the very stark decline that you've seen in the US. The US and the UK, both countries, there's certainly two dominant parties. And that means that you simply have less to choose from as a voter. The more continental tradition, we get coalition governments, what we'd call the cooperating democracy. And compromise is really built into that type of political system.
With the ghetto law, they're trying to make the Danish society stay homogeneous and similar to each other. We're trying to divide the immigrants out and be a normal part of the Danish society. I think it's the best way to try to get the Danes to meet each other and not just be in closed societies in the Danish society.
We're very opposed to how society works many places in the US. New York would be one example, where you have Chinatown for people with Chinese descent, and you have areas with people with African-American background live. If you have this division of our cities, then we can't have a strong society together where you pay taxes for having the same opportunities.
Traditionally, Denmark is a monoculture, so there haven't been that many immigrants. A sense of belonging to the nation is quite high in Denmark. This solidarity is, of course, challenged by increasing diversity. This strong connection to the country also develops a little bit into a demarcation towards other groups. The Social Democrats said they want to reduce the number of asylum seekers to zero. So this attracted a lot of attention in the international press. Hungary and Denmark are the only countries in Europe that decided Damascus is safe again and that Syrian refugees can be sent back. That was also very criticized.
Most trusting societies are not always the most homogeneous. They are the ones in which common social and political institutions bring people together so that they can recognize that they have huge amounts in common, that they all want a stable society in which they can grow old and their children can grow old and they can imagine a better life for themselves.
It's a lot easier to break trust than to build it. It's definitely possible because if you look at places that have been torn apart by conflict, there are cases where governance is put back together. It needed dialogue processes, contact strategies. In conflict zones where you have different groups that have either inflicted or received huge levels of violence from the other, you know, the different groups are segregated geographically and they don't ever kind of encounter each other, it makes it easier to build a kind of stereotype of the other and dehumanize that other. If you put people together, then it humanizes people. But for me, the most important thing is to go back to re-establishing some common norms and foundations for what we want our society to look like.
The old system is not working, and it is an old system. It was conceptualized and designed in the 18th century and slowly democratized and improved over time, but not that much. If you look at the parliamentary procedures in Britain or the US, it's almost folkloric, you know, and quaint, the way certain decision processes function. That just doesn't work for people anymore. So citizens' assemblies and random selection seems to me a good solution to a lot of the issues, including polarization, including lack of trust in each other and in the people who represent us.
Critical citizens are definitely, you know, a fundamental part of any democracy. People need to be thinking critically and holding the government to account and making sure that they do deliver on those promises. So sometimes, if the trust is broken in a particular government, we would then expect at the next election for that government to lose. Most of the time, we think that the ideal is some sort of mistrust.
But it's quite problematic when a lot of people are not just critical or skeptical, but they are sort of deeply disaffected and cynical with government and don't believe in it at all. So I think what we might want to be looking for is a kind of healthy blend of like having trust in the sort of fundamentals of your system and your government and politics, being critical of them, but not deciding from the get-go that they are corrupt and untrustworthy and bad.
I think by far the most sensible attitude is to at least mistrust government and to want to check and scrutinize. After all, democracy was invented because people didn't trust government to act appropriately. So why should we abandon that position? So then, how do we give people the information so that they can come to the right decisions? Well, I think that's about providing some form of regulation over some forms of social media, so the worst types of misinformation and the worst types of fake news don't get too widely propagated. I think we also need politicians to focus on building relationships with their voters rather than simply just focusing on them at election time and trying to win their votes. The relationship has got to be sustained, because I think only with that kind of sustained engagement can you build trust. It takes a little bit of time.
The generation of students that I have in front of me, they are put together through social media. They're linked together in a way that most generations haven't been. And they have a sense of efficacy when it comes to issues that are near and dear to the heart of young people. They are able to come together and try to affect, and often do affect, policy in local communities in a way that's very, very powerful. They are probably the solution to this problem. They are going to have to approach their partisan opponents in a way different from the way partisan opponents approach each other now. They have to find common ground and do politics differently than the same old way that has produced the problems that we have. A generational change is probably the best hope that we have for making our political system work better in the future.
There's too much politics going on at the moment. You little trust maker. You're joking. Not another one?
This morning, I want to talk about the future of Europe.
I assured the Prime Minister of our determination to preserve democracy.
Senior ministers, senior advisors like me, fell disastrously short of the standards that the public has a right to expect of its government in a crisis.